Good morning. Oh boy, that was, oh, come on folks. Well, we've had VBS all week, right? Good morning. That was a little better, yes. So yeah, we had VBS, it was awesome. Some of you may still see some of the decorations laying around, so we had a great time. I want to thank you if you helped in any way come to VBS. If you helped in any way in VBS, would you just raise your hand? I won't ask you to stand up, you're still too tired. So we still got a few who made it here. Yes, thank you guys for helping with that. And we won't see it this week, but next week we'll see the video and you'll hear more reports about it. We have to give people a week off to rest, recuperate, and get over VBS before we can start talking about a lot more. But I want to thank you guys for that and appreciate you helping out. Also next week you're going to hear about Super Summer, our youth camp that we went on a few weeks ago. And continue to begin to pray for us also, because right after that is our breakthrough camp, preteen camp, 3rd through 6th grade. So we're going to be camped out by the end of this month. And so pray for us on that. So also for the weather and things like that. Now, if you have a prayer request of any kind, there should be a prayer request form in front of you. You can fill that out. You can drop it in the offering box at the end. We take up our offering at the end of the service as you go out. You can put that in there. Or you can go online. There should be a QR code around there as well, too. You can just take a picture of that. Take you right to our prayer request that goes right to our prayer ministry team. Now, they are still meeting, by the way, on Wednesday nights. If you'd like to come out and pray with them, if you can't, let Deborah or Charles know, and they'll get you on the list, and you can get the prayer request and still join them. Even though you can't be here, you can still be a part of the prayer team. We'd love to have you do that. So, good to see everyone out here. Yes, our AC is working for whatever brought you in. If it was just because it's too hot outside, people have asked me if I'm going to start preaching on hell more, because that way I can say, if you think this is hot, just wait and see. But I'm thinking about it. We'll just leave it at that, okay? But as we go into this time of worship, will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time to gather together. Lord, thank you most of all for the reason to gather together. Lord, that we could come into your presence. And Lord, that we could actually have an audience with the creator and sustainer of everything. And Father, the only one who brings us hope is you. You did it through your Son, Jesus Christ, dying in our place at the cross of Calvary to give us true eternal life. And Father, then you allowed us to have a relationship with you that will continue on through in eternity. And Father, you have promised that nothing would separate us from you. Nothing would snatch us out of your hand. And Father, I thank you for that. But Father, you know the weeks that these folks have had. Father, you know the struggles that they have. Father, you know the worries, the fears. Father, you know the questions that are in our hearts. And Lord, I pray that today that anyone here, Father, who has any of those things, Lord, they could put them down for just a little while and listen to you. Father, I pray that you would be worshipped in the songs, in the prayers, in the sermon, and even in just people that we pass by, coming and going. But Father, I pray that all glory goes to you. Thank you again for your love and your grace. It's in your name we pray, Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Please stand and worship with us.
My God, my Savior has rescued me.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are.
Glorify, glorify the name of
You are here. moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are the way maker, miracle worker, promise king, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are the way maker, miracle worker, promise king, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here.
Faith. And what we do is we realize we leave a legacy when we are on this earth. Whether we like it or not, we both join a legacy, but we also leave a legacy, so we become a part of one. And again, whether you like it or not, you have one. It may not be much of one, or one that you wanted, or one you intended, but you have one, and you are a part of legacy. So as we're going through this book of Judges, we're looking at God's people, the people of Israel, the different tribes, and how they continue to not fully follow God, and they continue to take steps away from God, and every time they did, it's like they got further and further. But we saw the process. If you've been studying with this, or if you're familiar with this book, there's a process. What happens is the people turn away from God. God takes his hand off of them, his hand of protection. Other people come in and they oppress them and they control them. And then the people cry out to God, and he brings a deliverer, a judge. And then the people return to God, and as soon as the judge is no longer judging and no longer leading, the people sin again. They turn away from God again. God raises his hand again. Other people come in. And we see this happen over and over again, but what we see is not just so much this cyclical process, but a spiraling downward. Every time they take a step away from God, it gets worse and worse and worse. And as we see this going through here, we've seen judge after judge and God's amazing work, miracles after miracles, and still the people over time go, we'd like to have someone else be our God. We want something different in life. Now, today is one of the touchiest subjects I could bring up for you. Parenting. There is a story of a pastor who was a young pastor, and he had a sermon on parenting. How to parent children. Well, then he got married and had children. And he changed the title to Suggestions of How to Parent Children. Then his children became teenagers, and he refused to preach that sermon ever again. So this is kind of how it feels like when I'm doing a sermon on parenting. Now, I got this title, this is called The Toughest Job You'll Ever Love, because it's so true about parenting. And how many people in here are parents? Yeah, you may be grandparents, but you're still parents, so you know what I'm talking about, okay? And kids, learn from this, because one day you'll be sitting here as parents hearing this and going, I remember my parent raising their hand and looking at me afterwards. So you're going to have that same look, I promise. Now, this phrase, if you know this phrase, the toughest job I've ever loved, this actually comes from the Peace Corps. When they started the Peace Corps in the 1960s, John Kennedy started that. And this is the motto they have. This is the toughest job you'll ever love. And I think they got it because none of them were parents yet. Otherwise, they would not use that. This is the second toughest job you'll ever love. Parenting is so tough. We have it, our ideas of, you know, and famous last words of a parent, I'm never going to do that when I have kids, and then you do it every time. But parenting, you know, we have this idea of how it's going to look, and all the loving, and just the family photos, and we're so much fun, and then you actually have the children, and they're born, and then you realize, I'm not sure I'm going to live through this, I'm not sure the kids are going to live through this, I'm not sure if I care if the kids live through this some days. It's just tough. 2:30 in the morning, they're throwing up and they're doing all kinds of other stuff. There's things that come out of those little bodies. You have no idea how it got in there. And the amazing thing is that'll happen, and yet you'll worry all day about it. You will worry that it's going to happen again, and when it does, you're right in there. One of the times, my children, I love them, but one of the times that my daughter just broke my heart, she didn't mean to. She was about 2 years old, had a virus. She was throwing up middle of the night, so I got up and cleaned her up, and she looks, she goes, I'm so sorry, Daddy. Sweetheart, don't apologize for this. It's not like you did it on purpose. Of all the times you should have apologized to me, this is not one of them, okay? And it just crushes you whenever they get sick. And it hurts so bad, and I realized why when God said, yeah, I know why you don't like them when they're sick, because when they're misbehaving, you can control that, you think. You can get this over with, but when they're sick, it's totally out of your hands. And you don't know how this is going to happen. And that is parenting in a nutshell. Well, listen, we're going to start our study through, continuing through Judges, of course, but now we're on to Samson. We've all heard the stories of Samson, so maybe you're going to learn something new about him during this study. Maybe not. I hope so, but feel free to read ahead, by the way, if you want to. I'm not offended by that in any way. But we're going to start off with learning about his parents, and this is one of the things I want you to look for as we're studying through this. Parenting is part of God's work and plan for the kingdom work. God uses the family to teach us a lot about him. I tell this anytime I do premarital counseling and anything like that, because what God uses in the family, and you can look all through Scripture. By the way, I double dog dare you to challenge me on this and see if I'm right or wrong. I'd love to discuss it with you. But God uses the family to teach us about our relationship with him. I honestly didn't know unconditional love until I had kids. How could I not get so bad that God would turn me away? I understand that now. I also understand the need for discipline in my life when I had kids. My wife figured it out when she married me, but it took kids before I knew it. But I also understood forgiveness, and I also understood the need, and I also understood worry a lot deeper when I had children. I understood commitment, and I understood all of these things, you know, when I got married, and it just, everything became more tangible to me. And God said, this is what I want you to know about me. So he uses our families to teach us, and I will even go this far. Sometimes he uses our families, not like he intended, but he will use them to teach us what not to do. Now, I will just say ahead of time, I was a spiritual orphan. In other words, I was the only Christian in my family, so I went to church by myself. My family believed in God, but there was no worship of God. That's fine if you want to do it, but don't you dare bring it home. So whenever I went to church, I was watching these other families to see how you're supposed to live like a Christian, because I knew I wasn't going to get it at home. And I'm going to tell you now, folks, there are other people watching you trying to figure it out as well. Now, James Dobson said years ago, and I love this, he said, your kids can handle imperfection, but what they can't handle is injustice. Your kids can handle when you do something wrong and you have to go to them and admit you were wrong. They can handle that. They understand imperfection. But what they can handle is when you go to them and say, well, I'm an adult. It's okay. No, it's not okay because you're an adult either. And that's when they start having problems with us. We actually had our first child was our dog, Prince, and he was our practice child. Because, you know, if things go really, really wrong, you just bury him in the backyard and not talk about it anymore. But we had him for 16 years, by the way, so it went well. But I remembered that Julie and I said that when we got him. Lord, we really want to learn how to raise children. So one night, I'm walking him before we put him up. I had no kids yet, and he's doing his dog stuff, okay? He's got to stop and sniff everything. 2 or 3 times. So I got stuff to do. I was in seminary, still working on my master's. And so I'm dragging him. Come on, fine. Prince, let's go. And I'm about to lose my cool with him. I really am. And at that moment, God said, I want you to apologize to your dog. Because he's just being a dog. But you are about to lose it over nothing. And I thought, you got to be kidding me. I got to apologize to this dog. You said you wanted a practice child. You said you wanted to learn. Let's do it. So there in Watauga, Texas, who knows who was looking out their windows, I said, Prince, sit. And I had to apologize to my dog. Unfortunately, I've had more practice apologizing to my kids since then. I didn't know it was going to set a pattern, but, you know, that's just how life goes with me sometimes. So as we look through here, I want you to think about parenting. Not the perfections of it, because there is none. But how is God going to use it? How does he use it, and how does he want to use it? And Samson is going to teach us a lot about that, but we're going to start with his family. So look with me in chapter 13, starting in verse 1. And the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, so the Lord gave them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. There was a certain man of Zorah of the tribe of Danites whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and had no children.
And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, "Behold, you are barren and have not borne children, but you shall conceive and bear a son. Therefore be careful and drink no wine or strong drink and eat nothing unclean, for behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. No razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite to the Lord, to God from the womb, and he shall begin to save Israel from the hand of the Philistines." Then the woman came and told her husband, "A man of God came to me, and his appearance was like the appearance of the angel of God, very awesome. I did not ask him where he was from, and he did not tell me his name, but he said to me, 'Behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. So then drink no wine or strong drink and eat nothing unclean, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb to the day of his death.' Then Manoah prayed to the Lord and said, 'O Lord, please let the man of God whom you sent come again to us and teach us what we are to do with the child who will be born.' And God listened to the voice of Manoah, and the angel of God came again to the woman who sat in the field. But Manoah, her husband, was not with her. So the woman ran quickly and told her husband, 'Behold, the man who came to me the other day has appeared to me.' And Manoah rose and went after his wife and came to the man and said to him, 'Are you the man who spoke to this woman?' And he said, 'I am.' And Manoah said, Now when your words come true, what is to be the child's manner of life and what is his mission?' And the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, 'Of all that I said to the woman, let her be careful. She may not eat of anything that comes from the vine, neither let her drink wine or strong drink or eat any unclean thing. All that I command her, let her observe.' Noah said to the angel of the Lord, 'Please let us detain you and prepare a young goat for you.' And the angel of the Lord said, 'Noah, if you detain me, I will not eat of your food, but if you prepare a burnt offering, then offer it to the Lord.' For Noah did not know that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, 'What is your name, so that when your words come true, we may honor you?' And the angel of the Lord said to him, 'Why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful?' So Manoah took the young goat with the grain offering and offered it on the rock to the Lord, to the one who works wonders. And Manoah and his wife were watching. And when the flame went up toward heaven from the altar, the angel of the Lord went up in the flame of the altar. Now Manoah and his wife were teaching, and they fell on their faces to the ground. The angel of the Lord appeared no more to Manoah and his wife. Then Manoah knew that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to his wife, 'We shall surely die, for we have seen God.' But his wife said to him, 'If the Lord had meant to kill us, he would not have accepted a burnt offering and grain offering at our hands, or shown us all these things, or announced to us such things as these.' And the woman bore a son called his name Samson. And the young man grew, and the Lord blessed him. And the spirit of the Lord began to stir in him at Menahah, Dan, between Zorah and Astra." So again, this is a story of Samson, and we kind of know what's coming if you're familiar with Samson at all in his life, but this is how it starts. Everything starts with a family, whether you like it or not. Again, we all have a family, and this is what I love about the Old Testament when we read through that, because we get to see a lot of family things, a lot of lineage. It's easier in the Old Testament to trace somebody from their birth to their death, before and after in their lineage, than it is the New Testament. We have a little bit, but it's not as easy to go through that, where we love to do that here, and this is a great place. So we have this angel of the Lord who comes and tells this woman, "You're going to bear a son." And then he gives her some directions on that. And she goes and tells her husband, and he says, "Wow, that's awesome." So he says, "Well, we don't know what we're going on." So the man appears again, this angel of the Lord, and we're going to talk about that in just a second, what that is. And he tells him again, make sure she keeps the certain way of life. You're going to have a son. Now, man, this is just so us. They realize it's an angel of the Lord. And the first thing he says is, "We're going to die." Thank you, women, for having some peace of mind and going, "Well, you know, I think we would have already done that. Otherwise, he wouldn't have wasted time telling us what all was going to happen and taking our offering. So we're probably okay." And she has a son, and his name is Samson. But again, I want us to look at this story a little deeper. So first off, we have this random couple, okay? But before this even starts, we have this same thing that we always have. The people did evil again. Once again, we have this downward spiral. The people, once the pressure was off of having a judge watching over them and this deliverer there passed away, the one before them, and then we start back in our old ways, our old habits, because we're humans. So they have these people, and they start to turn away. But then God goes to this man and his wife. Now, the wife doesn't get a name, I'm sorry, but she doesn't have a name in Scripture, but the husband does, Manoah. And pronounce it however you want to. As my professor in seminary said, your Hebrew mother is dead. Just do the best you can with it, okay? So he is called out. Now, obviously, though, God works through faith, okay? He can work through faith to get his will done, or he can work through the absence of faith to bring judgment. So this time he's working through faith, and that's what he prefers if you look all through Scripture. So obviously these people had some faith. Not everybody around them was without faith in God. So don't ever think you're the only one who's living for Christ if you do. Elijah thought that, and God said, Elijah, I have thousands who have never bent the knee to Baal. You're not the only one. You're just the only one you see. And that's why God plants you there sometimes. Because remember, you put a light in a dark place. So don't ever be afraid when you think you're alone. You are not. But here's Manoah and his wife, and God calls them up. They have no children, and they're also of this tribe of Dan. Now where they're at, the Philistines show up here. They've been mentioned a couple of times, and if you're familiar with Bible stories at all, the Philistines are going to have a major part in this. As a matter of fact, it says that it's went 40 years. That's a long time. But this is the, scholars believe that this is actually during that 40 years when Samson shows up. This is not after the 40 years and God finally brings it. Because if you remember what he said, God is going to start the delivering with Samson. Not going to complete it. So he has this couple who have no children. There's a tribe of Dan. And where they live is in Zorah, and it's kind of the southern part of their territory, right near where the Philistines are. Think about like Brownsville or, you know, somewhere along the border towns. This is where they live. So they would have easily gone in and out of Philistine territory all the time. So this is kind of strategic that God would call them there. So after this, though, an angel of the Lord shows up. Now, this has happened before if you've been through our study. Gideon had an angel of the Lord appeared to him, and this is where I brought in this word, theophany. Okay, sounds like a Greek word because it is. A theophany is basically what happened in the Old Testament when Christ showed up. Yes, that same Christ from the New Testament. It's called the preeminent Christ. It wasn't the Christ who was Jesus, like we know him in the New Testament, the incarnate in flesh, fully God, but fully man, who walked among us. But it was Christ, the second person of the Trinity, who did appear. They didn't know it. They thought it was just an angel of the Lord, a messenger of God. The word angel literally means messenger. So they thought it was a messenger of God who came to deliver this. And they said, oh, wow. But then when they realized, when he went up into the flames, they said, that wasn't just an angel. We have seen the face of God. And now you know why they fell on their face and thought, surely we're going to die. No one can handle that. But that's the amazing thing about Christ, is that not only did people get to see the face of God, they got to touch the hands of God and got to walk with God himself. And he dwelt among us. Go back to the Gospel of John. It's a beautiful story. So here is the angel showing up, and he informs them that they're going to have a son. Even though they don't have one, they've never had children, we don't know how old they are, probably upper in age, because, you know, at this time they're thinking, well, it's never going to happen, we're barren. But they're going to have a son, and he's going to deliver his people. Sound familiar? God does this again later, I promise. There's a spoiler alert. So he brings them out and he tells them this. The mother and child are going to have what's called a Nazarite vow. Okay? This was a vow made to God by someone. The word Nazarite literally means to be set apart or to be separated out. And what would happen is a person who took a Nazarite vow would take this vow for a limited time, although here we're told that it would be for the whole life of the child, and this time the mother has to take it because the baby's not even born yet. And the Nazarite vow was very serious. As a matter of fact, they give the whole requirements of it in Numbers chapter 6, and let me read some of these out to you. And he shall separate himself from wine and strong drink. He shall drink no vinegar from the wine or strong drink, and shall not drink any juice of grapes or eat grapes, fresh or dried. So in other words, he couldn't even eat grapes off the vine, just in case. Hard rules. It goes on. All the days of his separation, he shall not eat anything that is produced by grapevine, not even the seeds or the skins. All the days of his vow of separation, no razor shall touch his head. Keep that one in mind. If you don't know the story, you will. Till the time is completed when he separates himself. All the days he separates himself to the Lord, he shall not go near a dead body. Not even for his father or his mother or brother or sister. If they die, shall he make himself unclean because his separation to God is on his head. If any man dies very suddenly beside him, he defiles his consecrated his head. Now, it goes on to give us a lot more of that. But basically, no wine, no fermented drinks, nothing from the vine. Don't even eat the seeds or the skins, just in case. Completely separated. Don't even go near a dead body, not even if it's your own father or mother during that time, or a close relative. Cannot do it. And no razors to touch his head at all, because his hair was seen as a sign of his commitment to God. The longer it grew, the longer his commitment, kind of, it was the idea. But once he was done with his time, he set a lot of time for his commitment to God as a Nazarite, then he would shave his head and also make an offering and things like that. But this child will be a Nazarite until the day of his death. But the mother also has to take this vow as well. So she can't eat anything from the vine. She can't go near any dead bodies. She can't do any of that. Because God says, I want you to set the pattern that you're going to have for your child. When I was in seminary the first time, we didn't have kids. But the second time I went, because I'm just a glutton for punishment, we did have kids. So my kids would come to me and say, oh, this homework, I can't believe it. I'd say, really? Let me show you my homework. And they quit complaining really quickly after that, you know. You got 2 pages to do. Awesome! I've got 24 pages to write on 5 verses, so don't bother me. But, you know, they learn, if you go through it too, they learn from that. And then we have Manoah who asked this eternal, ultimate parenting question that if you haven't asked, you should. And he asks this in verse 12. What is to be the child's manner of life, and what is his mission? That word mission there literally means what is his work. Some of your Bibles may say what is his undertaking. So what is this child's manner of life to be? What is his mission? And as a parent, we have all of our plans. We have all of our ideas of what we want them to do, and I hear people talking about that all the time. Oh, when I have a daughter, she's going to be dressed in pink, and when I have a son, he's going to play baseball. And when I have, and then you get up and your kids hate pink, and they don't want to play baseball, and they do something, and you're like, where did they get this from? So you start blaming each other whose side of the family that came from. You don't know your kids yet, but I can promise you God does. And he has a plan for all of this, just like he has a plan for every one of us. So what is your child's manner of life supposed to be according to what God would bring? And what is the mission of your child? And I can tell you, God has one, and he will call your child to it. But he will do it through how you raise them, or sometimes despite how you raise them. But parenting has a purpose. Okay? Well, let's take just a second and look at the people's needs here. We mentioned that the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight. The Lord raised his hand off of them, and the Philistines came in. Now, I want you to notice something that doesn't appear, that if you've been through this study of Judges, you've seen it before. The people aren't asking for help. Did anybody catch that when we read it? Before, all the other times, all the other judges, it said God would raise his hand, certain people would come in and oppress them, and the people would cry out for God to help them, and this time they're not doing it. And remember, it says 40 years. So as far as we know, this is a difference that we're going to see, is that this is not so much a hard life oppression, it's more of a taking over, and the people are giving in. Now, the danger of that is, if you become numb to sin, you'll become numb to holiness. When sin doesn't bother you anymore, then you don't really concern yourself with God's holiness. And remember, if we are separated from God's holiness, we are separated from God. That's why Christ came, that we could be seen as holy once again. That his blood would cover us as an offering, not because of what he did, but because of what we did, and that we would be there again. But if we no longer care about that, it's not going to bother us, then it's not going to bother us exactly how we live. If we live according to the world's ways or God's ways, it doesn't really matter as long as you don't bother me. And we can start being numb to these things, and apparently this started to happen. We see this real shift in the book. This is going to be the last judge we have named, by the way. It's not the last judge of Israel, but the last judge in this book, because what happens during this 40 years is that this begins when the people are starting to really turn away. And I'll tell you, when they're delivered from the Philistines, we'll be on through the book of 1 and 2 Samuel to King David will deliver them from the Philistines. So this 40 years takes a while to get through. Some scholars even wonder if Samson and Samuel weren't maybe contemporaries, crossing paths sooner or later. And also, Samson is not going to be the great military leader. All the other guys raised up a force, and God called people out of their people, and there Samson doesn't do that. He's the only one. You may be the only person God puts in there to be a voice for his righteousness. But you are a part of his plan. He has not left you alone nor abandoned you. He is setting something up, and you are the beginning stages, maybe. Or maybe you're just another part of that plan. But don't ever think God has abandoned you if he's called you to do it. And we see this shift to where the people are no longer asking God for help because it's okay. It's not that bad. Again, this spiraling down further and further. And by the way, if you want to read further in the book of Judges, I'm going to tell you, it has a gruesome, brutal end. I will do my best to clean it up as much as I can, but it ain't pretty. I'm just warning you ahead of time. God, in his mercy, even though the people haven't called out, even though the people haven't cried out, God still sends a deliverer. God says, I know how your life is going, even though you say, we're fine. I know how this is going, and I'm still going to provide. This is where we see God's grace. And by the way, does this look familiar to anyone else? Because there's another place we see God bringing a deliverer when the people weren't even asking. Okay? Romans 5:8 tells us this. But while we were still yet sinners, before we got good, before we straightened up, before we even realized that we were separated from God, before we even knew to ask, Christ died for us. It really concerns me, but it's also frustrating when people say, I need to come back to church, but I'm trying to get a few things straightened out first. It's like having your arm cut off and you say, well, as soon as this stops bleeding, I'll go to the doctor. As soon as I can get better, I'll try to go to the hospital. You don't get better and go to the hospital. You go to the hospital so you can get better. You don't come to church after you straighten some things out. You come here because you need to straighten some things out. And if you think you're sitting around a lot of perfect people that have it all together, don't make me ask for testimonies. Because we have people in here who will be honest with you, okay? If you think you're looking at anyone in this room that has it all together, Satan is lying to you. Do not believe that. Starting right up here, I'm going to be honest. Now listen, we don't want to flaunt or brag about it, and we'll probably regret a lot of the stuff. But the truth is, every person in this room has had to be delivered by Jesus. Even before we knew it, though, God was setting that plan in motion. That Christ would come and die for us. The people had needs, even though they didn't see them as needs anymore. So, God brings this preparation. And when God does it, first thing He uses is the faith of the parents. Obviously, they knew God. Obviously, they had something to do with this. So, He uses this. And also, He's always wanted to use the family. Again, I've said that. Remember, God uses the family. He uses parents to prepare for His kingdom work. I'm going to share this passage with you. This is the parent passage, if you want to call it that. This is in Deuteronomy chapter 6. If you've never read it, write it down or come and look at it with me. I'm there right now. Starting in verse 2. That you may fear the Lord your God, you and your son's son, by keeping all His statutes and His commandments, which I command you all the days of your life, and that your days may be long. Verse 5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. We've heard that before, the greatest commandment. Now, verse 6. This is where it comes in, parents. Hang on. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. You will bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. Did you catch that in there? This is what I'm going to command you, and you're going to give it to your sons, and your sons' sons, and your sons' sons. And this is supposed to be generational. This is what I'm giving you, and I'm going to command that you do this. If God commanded it and you don't do it, by the way, the book of James says that's a sin. And He says, I want you to put it everywhere for them to see it. And the idea was that they would literally write it on their hands and have it in their arm, and they would have it in a little box on their forehead, so that when the children ask, what is that? They would say, I'm so glad you asked. And they would open it up and show them the Word of God, show them the law. And they would have it around them, not because the kids would already know it, but so the kids would learn it and start to ask about it. And when they did ask, that should be seen as a sign of God stirring in their hearts, a call to Him. He says, I want you to put these things around them so that they will see it and so that they will know it. Now, parents are as accountable to God for raising children as farmers are for raising crops. Just exactly how much am I responsible for my children? Especially after they've grown up and made their own decisions and things like that. Julie and I are getting to experience empty nesting. I've got to be honest, it's not all bad. I really was worried, but it's not too bad. I first noticed it when I started taking out the trash. I take out less trash. I can always tell when my kids are home. I'm thinking, I have extra bags here. Where did this come from? The laundry. I noticed that for sure, the laundry. Wow. One or two loads and we're done. It's like one day and we're finished. That's awesome. And the food bill, you can tell the difference in that. Now some of you guys are going, that's what I'm praying for. When I can go to the grocery store and not have to sell a kidney first, you know. But, you know, they still come around and we still live there. But how much am I responsible for? Well, I prayed about that. And the best way I know how to describe it is you're responsible for your raising your children the same that farmers are for raising crops. Now, this is very common to us, so think about our farmers and the work that they do. In essence, basically what a farmer does is he or she puts a seed in the ground and then waits to see what grows out. In essence, that's what it is, but I see all these farmers going, whatever. But what happened is, they started realizing after time, you know, if we put something in there with it, maybe it'll fertilize and grow more. And then maybe if we put it in certain dirt, it'll grow better, or certain times of the year. Or maybe if we don't even plant it, but we build up a mound and put it in that. And maybe when it does start to grow, if we do more things like put more water on it, or even keep too much water away from it, or if we keep the bugs off and all the other weeds away, maybe it'll grow more, and they begin to learn how to grow crops better so that you can yield more and more. So they start creating the atmosphere and the environment so the crops will grow to their best. But in the end, every farmer will tell you it's just a wait and see at the end of the year how it turns out. Same thing with parenting. What did you do to create an environment where they learn about God? You cannot make your children choose God. Some of us would love to do that. We can't. And I will be honest with you, when my daughter was 5 years old, she started saying, I want to go down front and get saved. And my wife and I, being the wise, you know, inspirational people we are, went, I don't think so. This is your pastor confessing now, okay? Because our children, being on a church staff, our children were pretty much born at church, all right? They were literally there, you know, from day one. My daughter went on more visitations when she was in a carrier than most of you guys have ever gone in your life, all right? We just took her up to the door. It's amazing. You show up the door with a baby in a carrier, knock on the door, these people let you right in. Apparently, you look harmless. So for her to come to us and say that, we're like, well, she knows all the answers already, so how do we know if it's really God stirring? And we felt too biased, so we sent her to our pastor, Brother Steve, and we said, Brother Steve, here's our situation. And he said, so let me talk to her. And Brother Steve came back and said, listen, I truly believe that God is calling this little girl to him. So if she wants to go down front, you should let her. We said, okay, thank you. It wasn't us thinking that. Honestly, it was us not even trusting what we'd seen. It's like, well, yeah, it sounds right, but it's too good to be true. If you know my daughter, you know that no doubt she's not perfect, but that was a real moment in her life. Parents, we do have a responsibility, and we will be held responsible for that, but how far does it grow? We did what we could to create an environment where they would learn about God. Now, God, again, is preparing this, but there's also this calling. And the first calling we see is this woman to be a Nazirite. I want you to notice this, by the way. She didn't ask. If you go to the beginning of the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel, you'll see this woman, Hannah, who is barren, and she's praying for a child. She's praying and praying. As a matter of fact, she says, God, if you would just give me a son, I would give him right back to you. And she does. As soon as he's old enough, she sends him back to the temple to be raised. We don't see the wife of Manoah doing this. She's just saying, this is my life, and I'm going to just be faithful to God with what I have. And she just goes to work. But then God shows up one day and says, today is your day, sister. But it's going to be tough, because you're going to have to make this Nazirite vow. And then we see him putting this calling on the unborn child. And by the way, your son will take this vow too. Samson didn't get to pick. And not only that, it's not going to be limited time like most of them. From the womb to the day of his death, he will be a Nazirite. He will never eat a grape. He will never cut his hair. He will never go near a dead body, including his own parents. That was the idea. He didn't get to ask. And you say, wait a minute, God, that's not necessarily fair. Let me tell you about the calling of God on our lives. Every person is called to faith. Every one of us. Micah 6:8 tells us, God has told you, O man, what is required of you. To seek justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. That counts every one of us in this room. Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 4 tells us all souls belong to God. Every soul is God's, including those people that you don't care much about. God cares so much about them that he gave his only begotten son to die in their place too. So there is already a calling on every one of our lives to be people of faith. So do not be surprised when God calls someone out even from the womb and says, I want you to be a part of my plan to redeem people back to me. And he sets that in motion already before he's even there.
Yeah.
Parents, you're going to be measured again. Again, first we ask, how much am I responsible for? But here's the next measurement. What are you going to be measured against? And I prayed about this, and this is the best I could come up with. Parents will be measured by God the same as they are measured by teachers. We have a lot of teachers in here, and teachers say that school is great if you can get rid of the students. But the only thing worse than the students are usually the parents. So I see my teacher friends going, I'm not saying anything. There's parents in here. But think about this. When your kids go to school and they start learning, how much are you responsible for that? I'm not working here all of a sudden. There we go. Okay. How much are you responsible for that? Well, you do have some responsibilities. Teachers can tell children that have environments at home that help them to learn. They know. And they know that when a parent shows up and tells them, oh, I don't understand. I'm always making them do their homework. I'm always telling them. They know better. Especially if they've taught for a few years. They can already tell the difference in the children who are encouraged and have the learning environment at home as opposed to those who don't. And they can also tell the helicopter parent and the lawnmower parents. When their little kindergartner comes in with this perfect rendition of the solar system that they did all on their own. Teachers know that the parents have made too many decisions for the children too, okay? It's got to be that balance. Where we have to help our children learn, but we also have to help our children know how to learn and learn how to learn. It is a balance in there, but the children still are responsible, and the children are the ones who still get the grades. It is up to us as parents to try to teach them about God, but it's still up to the child to be faithful in his or her own walk, because she or he is going to be held accountable for it. But remember, back in the garden, the first person God called out was Adam. Adam, what happened? Adam wasn't the first one to eat the fruit. Adam wasn't the first one to even talk about eating fruit. He was actually the last. But Adam was the one that God said, Adam, you're in charge. Which also means, Adam, you're responsible for all of this. So Adam, you're the first one I'm asking what went wrong. And dads, if you read Ephesians chapter 5, I'm sorry to tell you, we're the first ones that God's going to call up on Judgment Day. I have every belief of this. And say, okay, what happened in your family? Oh, it was that woman. It was those kids. It was the TV, the internet. It was always somebody else. But God will say, where were you during all of that? And ladies, please remember that whenever Ephesians 5 talks about submitting to your husband, it's not because he's so much better, it's because he has all the responsibility given to him by God. And he will be held accountable before you will. Keep that in mind. But here we have this family, and God is using them. So here comes our challenge. What is your goal in your parenting? Okay? Now, have you ever asked that parent a question? Oh, come on, work over here. Chapter 13, verse 12. When your words come true, what is to be the child's manner of life, and what is his mission? As a parent, have you ever asked that about your children? Have you ever prayed that about your children? God, what are my children supposed to do? Really? Not according to what you and I think, but according to what God wills. Now, I gave an earlier challenge about sharing testimonies with your children, that you should sit your kids down and say, listen, do you know my testimony? How I came to the Lord? And if they don't, then share it. If they do, then ask them and see if they get it right. But then the other challenge is to ask your kids, now, kids, can you tell me, just us sitting here, can you tell me what your testimony is? how you came to the Lord? Just a challenge. But it's a challenge to see where you and your kids are in your walk with God. Because I promise it'll come up later. Now, here's my last statement. It's never too late to try. Well, my kids are grown and they have kids and they have kids' kids and all this stuff. And it's never too late to try to be a spiritual influence on someone else. Okay? When our daughter was first born, we were in Wichita, Kansas. She was born in Texas, and we moved up to Wichita right after that. And a lady in our church, a lady named Lois Mercer, a godly woman, Lois and Joe, great couple. And Lois said, "Now, Jason, you know that your job of raising your children will be done when your children are done raising their children." And I said, "Lois, that sounds like a really long time all of a sudden." And she said, and she was a grandmother, and she said, "Oh, it is." But she says that's important. And I will tell you this, Lois and Joe know a lot about raising kids and grandkids. They were a wonderful couple. They were basically grandparents to Jacob and Amanda when they were born. Yet Jacob and Amanda don't even remember them. But I can promise you, Julie and I will never forget them and all the help they were being so far away from our biological families. Because sometimes you need to help someone else raise their kids, even though they're not yours. And the only connection you have is that God placed you in the same place. There was a reason. Parents, we have a tough job, and this world is not making it any easier. Please remember, this is part of God's plan. No matter how imperfect you are, no matter how many mistakes you've made, God says, "I can work through this." Oh, it's too late. It's not too late. You can at least try. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy that overcomes all of our sins. Father, those sins that we committed, Father, those sins that we knowingly committed, and Father, even those sins of the things that we ignored, the things we were supposed to do and haven't. Father, I pray right now that you would just be on every home that's represented here. Father, none of these families are perfect. But Father, your blood covers every one of us. And Father, I pray for parents now that you're stirring in our hearts the challenge to have an environment where our children learn about you despite the age of our children. Lord, maybe we have lost some time, but Father, I pray that we never lose hope. And I pray, Father, we continue to do that, to pray for our children, but also to teach our children your word and your ways. And Father, I pray that their best teaching method will always be our life and our example, that we would set a strong example for them, Lord, and we would always testify to our faith in you. Thank you again for your love and your grace, Lord. It's in your name I pray, Father. Amen. As we come to this time of invitation, we won't go long, but I will give an opportunity that if there's something stirring in you, stirring your heart, that you would like to handle at this altar, it's a great place. You don't have to come down here. You can do it right where you're sitting. But there is something about taking it as seriously as God does by coming down here. Maybe something you want to pray on your own. Maybe you want to talk with me, or we can set the time to talk later. Whatever you need, that's fine. But God is inviting you right now to join in His work in some way. So you have the invitation to either accept it or to reject it. And to hope maybe He asks again later. Maybe He will, maybe He won't, but we don't know. But today is the day to decide. Stand with us as we sing. Again, this altar is open for you. Join us as we sing.
Take your life, but I've heard 10.
Just help us to lead them, Lord, in the way that you want us to lead them. It's hard, Lord. We make mistakes. As Pastor said, we're going to make mistakes. But, Lord, help our end goal to be to point them towards you. Just help us have a good week. In Jesus' name, amen.